I hope I can live up to that introduction.
No problem.
Oh. So, this won't come as a surprise to any of you because it probably may describe you as well, but I'm a little bit broken. And I know this is true about you as well because we're all healers. We all got called into this work probably through some mechanism that Jung might call the archetype of the wounded healer. And sure, I imagine you're also here to help your patients with their experiences of grief. But I suspect you're also here to tend to your own grief, and that's a good thing. And I hope you can find some comfort in what I have to say. You know, I think sometimes when it comes to grief, we're a little bewildered in psychiatry by what to do with this somewhat vexatious visitor. And if everyone is going to experience grief in their life, is it really a disease? And if it looks like depression, should we be treating it as such? You know, I, like many of you, have probably struggled to know what to do in the face of patients who are grieving. It's worth saying that I have no financial disclosures to make. I'm not sure what those would be. Maybe stock in a Kleenex or something. Sorry, facial tissues. We try not to use brand names here. But I do want to make a little bit of a disclosure, and that's that, you know, sometimes when I stand up here, I feel a little bit like an imposter. I've mentioned this before. I feel a little bit like fraud. And in this particular case, I feel that way because I've been quite fortunate in my life. I have both my parents, I have a wonderful spouse, I have wonderful people who love me. I have not experienced tremendous amounts of loss, but I've also transited through this thing we call midlife. And, you know, Dante said this quite eloquently in the Inferno. He said, in the middle of the road of our lives, of my life, I awoke in a dark wood where the way was wholly lost. And in the process of finding my way home, I've had to encounter grief. And I just put a plug in for good psychotherapy as a way of dealing with that. But I also need to disclose that it's a lot easier to sit up here and talk about cannabis or bipolar disorder and hide behind charts and graphs than it is to come up here and be kind of vulnerable. So I want to dedicate this talk to my friend and colleague Eric Aroz, because Eric always spoke from the heart, and I want to be inspired by that today. So there's our rest of my disclosures and objectives. So I know that many people in this room have experienced and likely still are experiencing grief, and you're here for that reason, and that's what you're welcome. And you may also work with patients who are grieving and want some practical tips on how to navigate that landscape with them. We'll do that as well. But I think the best thing we can do to help our patients is to work on our own metabolization of our own grief experiences. You know, this is not an easy topic, right? I'm amazed that there are this many people here when it's so balmy and warm outside. So thank you for showing up to this. One of my mentors and friends, Bill Richards, who's done decades of work in psychedelic-assisted psychotherapy, is fond of saying, death is something that happens to other people sometimes. And I love that because it really kind of encapsulates the avoidance that we often have of this subject. But one of the things I want to convey about grief is that it is a process that cannot be rushed. The human heart tends to heal at its own pace, and I want to encourage you to pace yourself however you need to do that. If you need to regulate yourself by looking at your phone or taking notes or stepping outside, I welcome you to do that, to take care of yourself and let your own experience unfold as it wants to, at the pace that it wants to. And so to that end, today I want to bring into this room not only the sort of graphs and charts of our research science, but also the poets and the philosophers, for they've been exploring this landscape for a lot longer than this child we call psychiatry or psychology. So I'm going to ask the Buddhists and the existentialists and the Stoics what they make of this universal experience of grieving. And I love to cook, and my wife and I like to host dinner parties with people from different aspects of our lives. And so I want you to think about this talk as a kind of dinner party conversation about the experience of loss from some of my favorite wise thinkers from across time. And I'm going to do something that you're told in presentation school, not that I ever went, but you're told in presentation not to do, which is to read from your slides. And the reason why I want to do that is because I've been able to curate wisdom that is far greater than anything I could share, that I could have written myself. And so I want to respect those thinkers by getting their words right. And there's moments where I want to bring music into this talk, and because I think that's really how most of us encounter poetry these days. And so there's some brief clips of music, which I'm just going to let play for let it speak for itself. Also gives us a chance to kind of pause and digest. So I want to take a moment and ask you to just settle in and to befriend that part of your heart that might be holding a little bit of grief or pain. If you'd like to close your eyes or kind of take an upright position as if you were meditating, just to give yourself a little private internal space. So I want to just take a moment and read a favorite piece of poetry of mine by a guy named David Whyte. He has a beautiful Irish English brogue that you should do yourself a favor of listening to when you get home. You can easily find him on SoundCloud and such, but I'll do my best. So this is called Sweet Darkness. When your eyes are tired, the world is tired also. When your vision has gone, no part of the world can find you. It is time to go into the dark, where the night has eyes to recognize its own. There, you can be sure you are not beyond love. The dark will be your womb tonight. The night will give you a horizon further than you can see. You must learn one thing. You must learn one thing. The world was made to be free in. Give up all the other worlds except to the one which you belong. Sometimes it takes darkness and the sweet confinement of your aloneness to learn anything or anyone that does not bring you alive is too small for you. So Michel Hakim de Montaigne, arguably one of the first self-help authors in the 15th century, wrote what we would probably now call a blog, they called an essay, saying, the essential task of life is to survive love and loss. And sometimes my older patients come into me with this story. All my friends are dead. Such a sad dinosaur. So as often as clinicians, we work with our patients on the vicissitudes of their lives, or as we navigate the vicissitudes of our own lives, we're called upon to answer the call of these four little words, survive, love, and loss. The price of the capacity for love as a human being is to weather the loss of that love. Now, this impact of loss can be so significant that it can actually be fatal. In this study of 30,000 match controls in Britain, found that in the month following the death of a partner, that the surviving partner had over 2 times likelihood of dying themselves. This risk quieted down after about 30 days, but there was still a continued tail of this risk of increased death in the year or so following the bereavement. And how does this happen? I mean, I remember when I was a kid, people died of old age. I kind of missed that non-specificity. Well, not surprisingly, because this is a word you've certainly heard a lot today, inflammation is a key culprit. So you get this elevated pro-inflammatory cytokines, some of the same culprits we've been hearing about in depression, TNF-alpha, interleukin-6, et cetera. You get lower heart rate variability because of probably increased parasympathetic innervation to the heart. And this increases the risk of death. Now, interestingly, the risk is higher in men than it is in women. Actually, having a spouse die for a woman, curiously, is protective. But for a man losing a spouse, the risk of his death, it goes up by 1.7%. Well, sorry, 1.7 times. So, I'll let you draw your own conclusions about that. So what did we get taught about grieving in school? Well, most of us probably got Elizabeth Kubler-Ross. And Elizabeth Kubler-Ross had this very succinct stages of grief that we're all quite familiar with: denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. And when this came out in 1969, this was kind of radical because people didn't talk about death in 1969. We didn't have hospices, or we did, but they were just getting started. And so to talk about death openly was kind of a radical act. But she's made it quite clear in the time since that this was really a model meant for people who are facing death, not necessarily people who are left behind. And one of the problems with this model, as much as it's right with it, there's some of the problems with it, is that it creates this sort of linear expectation that we go in a straight line when it comes to grief. And some people have tried to add some level of complexity to this. I like this diagram because it sort of indicates that we go into the hole before we climb back out. But still, it's presented as this kind of linear process, which is why I kind of appreciated this parody. But how many times have you heard from a patient when they say, geez, I thought I was getting over this. I don't know why I'm angry again. I don't know why I'm thinking about it as I was 6 months ago. Well, because this is not a linear process. And so I've begun to think of the grief process as differently. So in California, where I live, we have these fantastic turkey vultures that fly over the landscape, the rolling hills. And what they'll do is they'll make these giant circles over the landscape, and they go higher and higher each time because they are riding a current of air which is rising up from the ground in a helix. And so they go higher and higher and higher. And I was watching these birds once, and I was thinking, you know, does that bird ever look down on the ground and think, damn it, I'm over that barn again. I thought I'd gotten past the barn. I'm over the barn again. And then 20 minutes later, he circles around and he says, oh, damn it, I'm over the barn again. Really? I haven't gotten anywhere. But this time he looks left and he looks right and he says, wait a second. I didn't realize on the other side of that ridge was the ocean. And is that where that road connects to? So you see where I'm going with this? That this recursive process of grief as we circle back over and over, that with each passing iteration, we get a chance to see a greater perspective, and we get to tie this into a sense of meaning or perhaps purpose from the thing that we've lost. And I think turkey vultures are kind of a perfect metaphor for this because they're a really important part of decomposition, which is really in some ways what a grief process is. It's a process of metabolizing and decomposing the love that we have lost. So, you know, we talk sometimes about complex grief and simple grief, and I don't know, I have an issue with that, because I think any grief that really matters to us is probably complex. And so, you know, the complications of that grief tend to be proportionate to the depths of the relationship that we have with the person that we lost, or the relationship that has ended, etc. So a more contemporary thinker who I'm fond of is a Jungian psychotherapist and Buddhist teacher, his name is David Rico, introduces this really parsimonious, elegant description of grief when he describes these three components. He says that grief is comprised of sadness that something was lost, anger that something was taken away, and fear that it will never be replaced. Now, I know you might be thinking, I know how to treat grief. I treat depression every day, right? But this brings us to a really critical question. Are grief and depression the same thing? Is complex grief the same as depression? And I would argue, as I mentioned, that many experiences of grief can be long and protracted because there is this quality of irreversible change when we're touched with grief. But at what point do we start to treat that experience as depression? And, you know, this is an important question because if every time we get our prescription pad out, as soon as we see tears in our office, we've really missed an opportunity. We've missed an opportunity to allow that healing to happen somewhat naturally if we can just kind of get out of the way of it. You know, Freud struggled with this question a century ago in his seminal essay, Mourning and Melancholia. And, you know, of course, what we would call depression, he called melancholia, and mourning, grief. Separating out that in mourning we're suffering from the separation from the loss of an object, and that in depression or melancholia we are suffering from a loss of part of our ego, and recognize that from the outside that many of these symptoms may look the same. The person is sad, they're lacking motivation, they're joyless, they have no energy, they might even be racked with guilt. But he pointed out that if you watch this over time, that a difference emerges, that we essentially have built-in technology as human beings to process most grief, and that once we've metabolized it, we return to normal, whereas a person with depression may feel stuck in this free-floating, persistent feeling of separation and rejection from the world and the people in it. You know, when people are grieving, it's so often because they have lost the ability to have a future with the person who they've lost. they have hope for the future in general, but the person on whom they focused their hope is now gone. But this is different than depression, because if you look at what William Styron said about depression in his very thin but powerful book, Darkness Visible, he said, in depression, this faith in deliverance and ultimate restoration is absent. The pain is unrelenting, and what makes the condition intolerable is the foreknowledge that no remedy will come, not in a day, an hour, a month, or a minute. If there is mild relief, one knows that only temporarily. More pain will follow. It is hopelessness, even more than pain, that crushes the soul. I think that is a key difference between depression and grief, is that sense that this will not get better. Now, we've struggled with this in the DSM for many years, and so starting in 1980, something called the bereavement exclusion, which cautioned when differentiating major depression from grief, that one should be cautious in the time shortly following a loss, not to diagnose depression. And there's been a lot of critique of this in both directions. Critics of this decision noted that the presence of this exception, you could miss the diagnosis of depression, and by missing it, you can have all sorts of complications up to and including suicide. Critics of removing the bereavement exclusion argue that we're going to medicalize a normal human experience of loss. And if we do that, then we may rush in with our standard treatments for depression too early, and that this might get better on its own. So this got batted around, and finally in DSM-5, the bereavement exclusion was removed. So now, conceivably, somebody could be diagnosed with depression the day after they've lost a spouse. Now, that may be accurate, right? Because they may have had depression already, but we should be careful not to mistake brand new experience of grief for depression. And the good news is that most people who experience grief are not going to develop depression. And this alone is probably our best argument for not rushing in too quickly. So 85 to 90% of people who have grief will feel better in 6 months or less. However, of those, about 10 to 15% of people will develop, what we would call prolonged grief, about 50 to 75% of them will have major depression. So we get this kind of concentrated sample of people that have experienced grief and then go on to develop a kind of depression. So obviously you have to use your clinical judgment in this case, but a lot of times we can take somewhat of a watch, wait, and support approach rather than rushing in too quickly to treat as depression. So there was a proposal for a prolonged grief disorder in DSM-5. It did not actually make the cut, but I think it was helpful in sort of identifying some of the aspects of prolonged grief. And what they were able to identify, and also some of the risk factors, some of the risk factors for developing a prolonged grief experience were a suddenness or violence of the death of the person who one has lost, which certainly makes a lot of sense. But it also talks about our past experiences of attachment and loss. So if somebody who had controlling or abusive parents or had childhood separation anxiety would be more prone to developing prolonged grief. And those who've had an insecure or excessively dependent attachment style may also be more prone to developing a prolonged grief experience, which kind of makes sense, because if you think about, if we've never learned to attach in a healthy way, departure is going to be that much harder. But one of the things that they identified, which I think is quite intriguing, is so these are the things that really stood out above the typical experience of depression, was that was apathy and yearning and emptiness. And I want to focus a little bit on yearning, because I think it's one of the things that is often captured very well in music. So you know this feeling of yearning, and Van Morrison does a really nice job of capturing this song Reminds Me of You, where you know you hear the words, but you also hear it between the notes as much as you hear the words. So let me just let it play.
Now it's a song. Seem like my heart is breaking into. It says no, but my soul demands it. Everything I do reminds me of you.
So Marcel Proust fleshes this out further, observing in Remembrance of Things Past that, quote, people do not die for us immediately, but remain bathed in a sort of aura of life which bears no relation to true immortality, but through which they continue to occupy our thoughts in the same way as if they were alive. It is as if they were traveling abroad. So why do we yearn? I thought this was a really fascinating question. And so, you know, we know from neuroimaging studies that we register emotional pain in the same areas of the brain that register physical pain. So areas such as the insula, the dorsal anterior cingulate, the periaqueductal gray. So these are the same areas of the brain that will light up if we're in physical pain as if we're in emotional pain. And we know rationally that no amount of wishing is going to bring somebody back to us. But yet we do it. And so this interesting study by Mary Frances O'Connor at UCLA a few years ago discovered in this fMRI study that when they showed subjects with grief pictures of their lost relatives coupled with either emotionally evocative words or neutral words, that when you showed the picture of the person that was lost with an emotionally evocative word, that the same areas of the brain that register physical pain will light up. This is not a surprise. But what's interesting is that people that had more complicated grief, marked by yearning, their nucleus accumbens, the same area of the brain that registers the pleasure of love or the euphoria of a line of cocaine, also lights up. So the brains of uncomplicated grievers did not activate the nucleus accumbens. So this really really drove the question for me: is longing addictive? Is yearning dependency forming? You know, does recalling the person that we lost give us a brief hit of pleasure, but ultimately has this sort of faux pleasure experience of cocaine, or leaving us wanting something deeper, something more satisfying? It's a fascinating finding. So often when we're grieving, the current grief that we are experiencing is just the outermost surface of past unexpressed grief. And we find ourselves sorrowful about a current loss, we're often feeling the grief of the past that we were unable to express at an earlier time. William Faulkner reminds us that the past isn't even The past isn't dead, it isn't even past. And David Rico, who I mentioned earlier, remarked that we're grieving more than just this ending. Many endings were stacked inside us, awaiting their chance for the attention of tears. And you know, we often find the experience of other people's grief hitting this kind of resonant frequency of our own sadness. I mean, we've all had this experience of finding ourselves tearful in a movie or to a song. It's how we communicate this as human beings to one another. And you know, it may be that those things that resonate with us are signposts as ways to find the areas of our own grief that we haven't fully metabolized. You know, sometimes this happens in mass. I happen to be, so my parents are English. I was this far from being born there. And so I'm very familiar with the culture of the stiff upper lip. That was something that I'm quite familiar with. But I happened to be in Bristol, England in August 1997 when I was staying in a friend's flat. And I got up on a Sunday morning and I turned the BBC on as I was making coffee on the radio, and there was this really funereal dirge music, and I thought, wow, you know, British are dark, but this is like beyond the pale for them. And this announcer comes on and says that Princess Diana had died in a car accident in Paris the night before. And I have to tell you, I have never seen anything like this in Britain. So here's this woman that vast majority of the British populace never knew, but absolutely adored. And when you went to Kensington Palace, there's 30 feet deep of flowers stacked up in front of it. And, you know, and I think what Diana did, and, you know, people called her the People's Princess, I think she gave them one final gift in her parting, which is that she allowed the British people, who typically been told not to express their emotions, to grieve those things that they've been holding on to all those years. It's not that they knew Diana. It's that they were grieving for the loss of their mother or their child or the relationship that didn't work out. I think that's what she gave them permission to do, and she kind of gave them cover so they could save face. So that it was a fascinating thing to watch. So a lot of times when a new grief occurs, it's really in one of our patients or in ourselves, it's really incumbent on us to be observant about how it might be creating this resonant frequency that makes past grief that isn't fully metabolized vibrate in sympathy. I mean, how often have you heard from a patient about a slew of complex emotions that emerged at the death of a parent, where the patient's own trouble in relationships or past ruptures with their parents or even ruptures going back as far as childhood come to the fore? And these all begin to kind of vibrate in sympathy with each other. So I think that's why even simple grief can be quite complicated. So how do we grieve? How do we do this? Right? Yeah, so often I think our biggest challenge is just to allow grief to happen. We create so many barriers for grief to occur and to be felt, from the expectations that we put on ourselves that we should be over this by now, or this arbitrary handful of days that we're permitted away from our jobs for bereavement leave. I worked in a job where you got 3 days off if you had bereavement leave. So, you know, should be over and get back to work, right? But I think, like the ancient Taoist sages remind us, water finds its way back to the sea if you leave it unencumbered. And grief, too, I think, seeks its own resolution. So oftentimes the work of grief is actually doing less and not more. Rumi reminded us that in seeking love, your task is not to seek for love, but merely to seek and find all the barriers within yourself that you have built against it. And sometimes we are called to do with our patients to help them see how they are stopping themselves from having the full experience of their emotions, whether it's through excessive intellectualization, drinking too much, or being so absorbed in their work that they can't feel the full weight of their sadness. So it's our job to create kind of a soft landing pad for these emotions so the patient can begin to move through them. And this tendency to heal from loss implies that there's sort of an innate healing capacity that we have in human beings, this way for the heart to kind of find its way back home. And this idea that we know how to heal if we can only just find and name the wound and then get out of its way with space and support is a theme that I'm going to return to repeatedly today. I want to read this quote from my friend Annie Mithoffer, who was one of the principal investigators on the MDMA-assisted psychotherapy protocols for PTSD, and she said in that protocol, that we often use this analogy of a person with a wound. The doctor or nurse can help by removing obstacles such as gravel and debris and can create favorable conditions, but it is always a person's own healing intelligence that does the healing. A doctor can set a fracture, but he cannot heal it. He can help, but he cannot heal it. Our trust in each participant's inner healer allows us to be present as the healing process unfolds. So let me ask you the question, could we accelerate this process by giving people antidepressants while they are grieving? There's a recent study in JAMA Psychiatry in which citalopram was added to a course of grief therapy, did not actually find a benefit unless the patient was also depressed. So I would say the answer to that is a cautious no. Now you might think, well, what's the downside? You know, this is a grief might predispose somebody to develop depression. But I would be cautious with that thinking, because remember, one of the side effects that we've talked about in other sessions with antidepressants is the experience of emotional flattening, right? And how many of you have had a patient who said, I really would like to be able to cry, but I can't. I used to cry in sad movies. I can't. Now, that's that emotional constriction that sometimes is a side effect of our antidepressants. So what do we do instead? Well, I want to encourage you to lean in and make it safe to be grieving. I think about a box of tissues as a box of permission slips. I keep two within arm's reach of my office all the time. And how many of you had handed a patient a box of tissues and had them apologize for crying in your office? And I say, if you can't cry in my office, I am doing a lousy job. Because if you can't cry in a psychiatry office, I need to find a new profession, honestly. So I think of that box of tissues, that's a box of permission slips. And I say, you go ahead and use as many as you want, I got more in the drawer. And I do. Put down the prescription pad. You know, we are going to feel uncomfortable, but we're nowhere near as uncomfortable as our patient is. And you might want to talk or refer or medicate, but I would encourage you just to wait an extra minute, to wait and listen and do as a Togawande suggests in his elegant book, Being Mortal, to wait an extra beat before speaking. Befriend your own discomfort so you can honor the space that your patient needs so badly in that moment. You know, Rilke spoke in letters to a young poet of, quote, why it is so important to be alone and attentive when one is sad. The quieter, the more patient, the more open we are in our grief, the deeper and more unerringly does the new thing enter into us. The better do we make it our own, and the more does it become our fate. So this attentive silence allows the patient to midwife their own grief, to attend to that sacred space, that liminal space between the worlds of what's disappearing and what's emerging. And, you know, I suspect that often we feel discomfort in the presence of grief because we feel in our grief in that moment what this writer Jamie Anderson called love with no place to go. And she said, it's understandable as clinician, she said love with no place to go, that the grief is just love with no place to go. And so it's understandable that as clinicians who've dedicated our lives to alleviating suffering that we want to do something. It's not that, but that may not be what our patients need in that moment. They need us to provide that safe ground from which they can navigate the landscape of their own grief. Because grief really wants little from us other than our undivided attention. It's very patient. And it will wait until you're done checking your email, until you're done pouring yourself another drink, or done telling yourself another story about why they left you. But, you know, grief really wants an audience with you. And it's not going to leave until it gets one. But once it knows that it mattered, then it tends to go on. It tends to metabolize and move forward, and that the sorrow begins to subside. So it's understandable that when we are in an unfamiliar landscape, to want to reach for a map. Psychotherapist Francis Weller has provided such a map in this lyrical little book called The Wild Edge of Sorrow, which I can't recommend highly enough. And he maps these territories in which we find these experiences of grief, and he calls them the five gates of grief because he talks about how you can enter into the experience of grief through any one of these. And I'm going to go through them in more detail, but in overview there that I'll just show you on the screen, and then I'll talk about them. So the first one is that everything we love, we will lose. Wow. Ouch. That isn't pulling punches. A good stoic. You know, even a relationship that lasts a lifetime will end with the death of one of the partners. Relationships end, people leave us, we leave others, employers lay us off, knees and backs go out. We can go bankrupt, and we can be betrayed by the very people we love. But we feel grief because we are capable of feeling love. We're experiencing love. And, you know, the losses may not even have to be traumatic. You know, David Whyte remarked in an interview, he said, you know, this is another delusion that we think we can take a sincere path in life without having our heart broken. And when you think about the path of parenting, there's never been a mother or father since the beginning of time who hasn't had their heart broken by their children. And nothing traumatic has to happen. All they have to do is grow up. Seneca reminds us in the faces, we have two choices. We can confront this, or we can deceive ourselves. What do we choose? You know, when we first experience this loss, there is this, it's as if everything comes to a halt. W.H. Auden captured this sense of sudden meaninglessness, this draining of color, in his 1938 poem, Funeral Blues, which I'm just going to read a short section of. He said, he was my north, my south, my east and west, my working week and my Sunday rest, my noon, my midnight, my talk, my song. I thought that love would last forever. I was wrong. And Eliot, T.S. Eliot goes on to talk about this disorientation that we have at the shock of loss. He said, in the wasteland, he said, what is that sound high in the air, a murmur of maternal lamentation? Who are these hooded hordes swarming over endless plains, stumbling in cracked earth ringed by the flat horizon only? What is that city over the mountains? Cracks and reforms and bursts in the violet air, falling towers, Jerusalem, Athens, Alexandria, Vienna, London. Unreal. This theme of falling towers is also mentioned in the tarot, which is really, you know, even though it's sort of thought of as a fortune-telling game, is really a catalog of human archetypes. But Eliot goes on to Anassis. He says, these fragments that I've shored against my ruins. He says, now that you're broken, what kind of relationship do you want to have with your brokenness? How do we relate to the broken parts? Can we be beautifully broken? Well, fortunately, some of my dinner guests that I've invited have some thoughts on this question. And Terry Tempest Williams, the writer, took up a serious study of mosaic in Ravenna, Italy, in the days after September 11, 2001. And she wrote about it in her book, Finding Beauty in a Broken World. And she said, a mosaic is a conversation between that which is broken. And Leonard Cohen, of course, famously sang in his 1992 song Anthem, ring the bells that still can ring. Forget your perfect offering. There is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. In Japan, there's an art form of mending broken pottery with glue that has precious metals, usually gold or silver. And what it does is it emphasizes, it's called kintsugi, and it emphasizes the broken parts rather than trying to hide them. And it's thought that this actually makes the pottery more beautiful and more valuable than when it was intact. Perhaps one of the most rewarding experiences I've had in my career is helping somebody who knows that they're actually dying. David Whyte often remarked that a real spiritual practice is to prepare for one's own disappearance. The challenges of moving through the five gates of grief are there for the person who's dying, but from a different perspective. And, you know, the loss doesn't have to be death. I'm thinking, could giving something up be considered a gift to the person who is receiving it? I'm thinking about a patient that I treated not too long ago who was having to give up a very esteemed position in his profession because of physical health problems. And it was a kind of job that, you know, it doesn't come around very often. And I asked him, I said, how did it feel when you first got the job? And he said, I was so proud. I'd walk around, you know, in my uniform and everyone knew what I was and what I did. And I said, what if when you give this up, you're giving that experience to the next person down the line? And he kind of smirked, smiled, and he said, you know, that would be a good thing. So I was thinking back to 2016 when we lost a whole bunch of musicians, including David Bowie and Prince and Leonard Cohen. And, you know, both David Bowie and Leonard Cohen knew that they were dying and had this opportunity to make farewell albums. And, you know, Bowie actually came out 2 days before his death was announced. And in classic David Bowie style, he made art out of his life experience, shaping himself into this phantasmic oracle character that kind of populates this bardo space between the worlds. And it had this album called Black Star, and this really kind of hallucinatory 10-minute long video, which I'm not going to show you here, but I just want you to hear the refrain in the song in his own words.
Something happened on the day he died. Spirit rose a meter and stepped aside. Somebody else took his place and bravely cried. I'm a black star.
So here he is looking death in the eye, and he's practically giddy at the potential of who gets to come next, who gets to be the next David Bowie, who gets to stand in David Bowie's space. Now, Cohen lived a lot longer, and so much that that his last two albums were clearly epitaphs. And it must be amusing to write a farewell album and then realize that you've been alive longer and that you have to do it again. You know? So this was a song from his first goodbye album, called Old Stories.
Going home without my sorrow, going home sometime tomorrow, going home to where it's better than before, going home without my burden, going home behind the curtain, going home without the cost.
practice stoic. He responds to his own impending death with a self-deprecating humor that sort of describes his own demise as a sort of stepping off the stage, a feeling of kind of relief that comes from somebody seeing their own disappearance as a kind of unburdening. So Weller goes on to talk about the second gate of grief. He says that we grieve the places that have not known love. And by this he means that we are carrying grief for things that were never there, the parts of us that wanted to be seen but were not, or the places, the times when we let ourselves down or allowed ourselves to be restricted from our full expression of who we are. And these are the broken and hidden parts of ourselves that are often at the root of our shame. And the Swiss psychoanalyst Alice Miller spoke of the grief that we feel when we realize that we were only seen by our parents as children when we are useful and flattering to them. And she says, quote, in analysis, the small and lonely child wakes up and asks, what would have happened if I had appeared before you, bad, ugly, angry, jealous, lazy, dirty, smelly? Where would your love have been then? And I was all these things as well. Does this mean that it was not really me whom you loved, but only who I pretended to be, this well-behaved, reliable, empathic, understanding, and convenient child who was in fact never really a child at all? What became of my childhood? Have I been cheated? Have I not been cheated out of it? And I can never return to it. I can never make up for it. From the beginning, I've been a little adult. My abilities, were they simply misused? And these questions are often accompanied by much grief and pain. You know, these unseen parts of ourself often trace a hollow, a kind of negative space that's more notable for its absence than its presence. You know, sometimes they feel like when you cut into these big sourdough bread in San Francisco where I live, and sometimes you cut into them and there's this big hole in the middle, a big hollow space because of the way that the bread ferments as it's rising. And they look solid on the outside, but they're empty on the inside. And I think these are some of the places that we may not think about when we think of grief, the parts of ourselves that were neglected in childhood, or worse yet, can become sources of shame as adults. And again, musicians are often better cartographers of these inner worlds than we clinicians. There was a wonderful chanteuse from Cabo Verde, a small cluster of islands in the Atlantic, where they speak Portuguese, a version of Portuguese. And her name is Cesária Évora. And she has this beautiful song, the title Saudade, is how it's pronounced in Cabo Verdean, or Saudade. And it really has no equivalent in English, but it might be described poetically as the presence of an absence, or the absence of a presence. And see, if, even though I don't expect anybody speaks Portuguese, so somebody probably does, the lyrics are less important than the feeling, so listen. Now, what does he mean by that? He says that we need as human beings to be seen and held by a larger community, and that this the presence of this grief has to do with a feeling of disconnection, not only from a family, but from a larger community of people that might give us the confidence to take chances in the world and be safe even if we fail. So this points to the need for grief work not only to be individual, but also communal as well, which I'll come back to towards the end. But this sort of theme of homecoming is something that Rilke described beautifully when he said, he spoke of this reunion of homecoming. He said, ah, not to be cut off, not through the slightest partition, shut out from the law of the stars. The inner, what is it, if not intensified sky, hurled through with birds and deep with the winds of homecoming? And Alice Walker alludes to this ground of our being, the humus. You know, when you think about the forest floor, the humus, It's interesting, that word comes from the same root as humility and humiliation, this idea of being taken to the ground that we return to time and time again. But it's also from this fecund ground from which new growth emerges. And in her poem, this is a recent poem from a book called The World Will Follow Joy, she says, if my sorrow were deeper, I'd be, along with you, under the ocean's floor. But today, I learned that the oil that pools beneath the ocean floor is essence, residue, remains of all our relations, all our ancestors who have died and turned to oil without our witness eons ago. We've always belonged to them, speaking for you, hanging, weeping over the water's edge as well as for myself. It is our grief, heavy, relentless, trudging us, however resistant to the decaying and rotten bottom of things, our grief bringing us home. So now we come to the fourth gate. And it's at this gate that we realize that we are connected to a larger world, and that our suffering does not just emerge from our own personal experiences, but rather we are connected to the soul of the world, what Jung might have called the anima mundi. And that when the world aches, be it from the displacement of refugees because of war, or to children being shot in schools, or seeing our fellow human beings sleeping on the street, we grieve too. We experience grief. And this grief is not just limited to the occupants of the world, but also to the planet itself. I spent this last July hiking the John Muir Trail, 275 miles, 4 weeks, from the just south of Mount Whitney to Yosemite, through this granite heart of the Sierra Nevada. And this range of light that John Muir called it, there are estimated to be 100 million dead trees that have died because of largely bark beetle infestation, drought, and climate change. And when there's enough dead wood, these forests can burn like a tinderbox. There was a period of time about this time last year when it felt like my entire state of California was burning from the Napa Valley to the Ventura coastline. And when these fires burn so hot, so completely, some of these landscapes and these beloved places that are a part of my soul as somebody who grew up in California are never going to be the same again. So I carry grief for that experience as well. And finally, we pass through this last gate, this ancestral grief that we carry both as individuals and as a collective. As I mentioned, my parents are British, and my grandmother lived through, who's now 97, lived through World War II. And during that time, she lost two siblings to the war, and within a few years later, a sister to TB. So she went from being one of four to one of none. And, you know, and I think about that. I never met any of those people, but I can't help but imagine that that experience of familial ancestral grief is, that I carry a piece of that as well. And we can carry this as a collective as well. Because I think from Standing Rock to Black Lives Matter to Me Too, we are seeing this groundswell of grief and rage from communities that have been carrying the wounds of injustice and prejudice for far too long. And I want to state that, you know, as a white man, I am the least qualified person to be talking about this, okay? But that doesn't excuse me from understanding about it and asking about it, and when I don't know, to ask the questions. You know, we need to have more clinicians that reflect our patients so that our patients feel comfortable when they walk in our offices, for sure, but until that day comes, we need to ask our patients about these experiences. And at the very least, we can take it upon ourselves to learn about these experiences. These are two short, powerful reads that have come out in the last year or two. Rebecca Solnit's Men Explain Things to Me, and Tanitzi Coates' Between the World and Me, which I can't recommend enough. But, you know, really, when we're treating our patients, if you don't know, be humble and ask. I've rarely had anybody get upset with me for asking what their experience of familial grief is. And I can't help but wonder, when we meet patients who have family histories just rife with mental illness, if there isn't this resonant frequency of fear and grief that how much life has been robbed from the families that we treat by mental illness, that there is this experience of grief from that loss as well. So now that we have this map of grief, how do we, what tools do we have for navigating the landscape? You know, I mentioned this morning in my talk that suffering and pain are not the same thing, and that we have the opportunity to work in this space where avoidance and attachment become evident. But how do we begin to do this? I think the first thing we have to do is stop moving around quite so much. And as far as I know, Pablo Neruda, the Chilean poet, was not a Buddhist, but he described this space that falls upon us when we at last stop running around from or towards our grief in this poem, Keeping Still. He said, "Now we will count to 12, and we will all keep still. And for once on the face of the earth, let's not speak any language. Let's stop for 1 second and not move our arms so much. If we were not so single-minded about keeping our lives moving and for once could do nothing, perhaps a huge silence might interrupt this sadness of never understanding ourselves and threatening ourselves with death." Meditation as a compassionate experience of sitting with our own suffering is something that we can teach our patients, preferably before they need it, but it's never too late. The Buddhist teacher Pema Chodron speaks of this spaciousness in her book, When Things Fall Apart, when she counsels, things falling apart is a kind of testing and also a kind of healing. We think that the point is to pass the test or to overcome the problem, but the truth is that things don't really get solved. They come together and they fall apart, and then they come together and they fall apart again. It's just like that. The healing comes from letting there be room for all of this to happen, room for grief, for relief, for misery, for joy. And a fellow Buddhist teacher and psychologist, Tara Brach, summarizes this even more succinctly, encouraging us when we want to push away a frightening or upsetting feeling, that to let that be welcome in our awareness as well with this simple phrase, "and this too," not either or. Chodron continues this conversation across the dinner table about freedom to choose, remarking, "The path is uncharted. It comes into existence moment by moment and at the same time drops away behind us. It's like riding a train sitting backwards. We can't see where we're headed, only where we've been." And this is an encouraging teaching because it says whatever the source of wisdom is, whatever is happening to us in this very instant, basically the instruction is not to try and solve the problem, but instead to use it as a question about how to let this very situation wake us up further rather than lull us into ignorance. This teaching applies to even the most horrendous situations life can dish out. Jean-Paul Sartre said that there are two ways to go into the gas chamber, free or not free. This is our choice in every moment. Do we relate to our circumstances with bitterness or with openness? And at that moment across the table, Jean-Paul Sartre, hearing his name, lights his pipe, looks up and says, "Yes, freedom is what you do with what is done to you." And this I have tacked up in my office. So Rico underscores this realism, reminding us that first and foremost, everything changes and ends, impermanence. And while this recognition of loss and pain that accompanies it lacks comfort at first glance, if we turn it over and look at the reciprocal, it also tells us that what we are feeling right now in our sadness, our suffering, will also not last forever. That it, too, must obey this given of existence and change into something else. He goes on further to define the vicissitudes of existence, reminding us that things do not always go according to plan, and that pain is a part of life. And it's in these two givens that we begin to appreciate the softening, that softening our resistance to change and our attachment to things being a certain way is another opportunity to change our relationship with suffering. So Rico lists these not as discouragement, but rather to remind us that it's our unwillingness to accept these givens as part of life to the primary source of our suffering. And he encourages us to see them as an opportunity to change our relationship to that suffering by saying an unconditional yes to these vicissitudes of life. And Nietzsche took this one step further, encouraging us not only to accept our fate with an unconditional yes, but to love it, what the Stoics would call amor fati, the love of one's fate, not merely resignation or even just acceptance, but love. And in choosing to say yes, we get to free ourselves from their grip. Rather than life being done to us, we are reminded that we have a say in how we respond to what happens to us. This is really the deepest kind of freedom. I'm sure you are all familiar with Viktor Frankl, the the Austrian psychiatrist and Holocaust survivor and great writer in existential psychotherapy. He said, forces beyond your control can take away everything you possess except for one thing, your freedom to choose how you will respond to the situation. And Marcus Aurelius, the Stoic, would agree with this, reminding us that you have power over your mind, not outside events. Realize this, and you will find strength. You know, David Whyte sometimes talks about that life is 50% mediated by what is disappearing and 50% mediated by what is emerging, and that we sort of sit on this threshold between those two points. It's a poetic way of looking at it. And that sometimes the passage of important people in our lives will cause us to question where we are in our lives. And Irving Yalom, the existential therapist, says he will sometimes take out a piece of paper and he'll draw a line across the bottom. He says, to the left, this is when you were born. To the right is when you will die. Where are you on this line? And from that point forward, you can start to have an important conversation about what's meaningful. Could grief bring us gifts? Absolutely. One of grief's gifts is a reminder that even though we may be grieving the loss of someone or something, we ourselves are still alive. We are here in this glorious world that all that it has to offer. Grief implores us to savor this fact, to linger, not only in our lives, but in the natural world around us and the relationships which enrich our lives. As I mentioned, I spent that month in the Sierras, and I got a lot of time thinking about reading John Muir's work, and he said, this is one of my favorite lines of his, he said, another glorious Sierra day in which one seems to be dissolved and absorbed and sent pulsing onward, we know not where. Life seems neither long nor short, and we take no more heed to save time or make haste than do the stars and trees. This is a true freedom, a good, practical sort of immortality. And Paul Bowles, the American beat writer, spent much of his life in Tangier. He wrote this line in The Sheltering Sky when he encouraged the simple but radical act of savoring our lives, when he said, he wrote, because we will not know when we will die, we get to think of life as an inexhaustible well. Yet everything only happens a certain number of times, and a very small number, really. How many more times will you remember a certain afternoon of your childhood, an afternoon that is so deeply a part of your being that you can't even conceive of your life without it? Perhaps four or five times more? Perhaps not even that. And how many times will you watch the full moon rise? Did anybody watch the full moon rise yesterday? Yeah, that was great, huh? Perhaps 20. And yet, it all seems limitless. So I often encourage my patients to reconnect with this natural world, even if it's just as simple as being outside. There's this wonderful term in Japanese called forest bathing, or shirin-yoku. It's not hiking, it's not going and exercising, it's just being outside in a mindful way. And it's interesting, it decreases rumination. There's a number of studies that have been done, but this is really about being connected to a larger world. And if you don't like being outside, you can encourage your patients to be of service. Do something which feels purposeful. So I'm back to thinking about my dinner party, which is starting to wrap up here, and then, you know, no dinner party is complete without music. And so I invited Tom Waits. You know, that wonderful bourbon-soaked, gravelly voice. He's at the piano in the corner of the room, and he's got this little simple admonition about how to savor our lives and the love that we have.
So if you find someone to have, someone to hold, don't trade it for silver, or don't trade it for gold. Cause I have all of life's treasures, and they're fine and they're good. They remind me houses are just made of wood. What makes a house grand? Oh, it ain't the roof or the doors. If there's no little house, it's a palace for sure. Without love, it ain't nothing but a house. House where nobody lives.
Oh, Tom. Every time, man.
With tissues.
I know. There were supposed to be tissues in this room. I want you to know I did request that there be tissues in this room. We'll be having words with somebody about that. So, you know, one of the ways that we can help patients make sense out of their loss is to help them write. You know, people say, oh, I don't know how to write. Yeah, you know how to write. I mean, there's some people don't know how to write, but most people can write. That this idea of leaving a record of our stories is a kind of immortality, but it helps to create a coherent narrative, which is so important when things fall apart. And we also need to come together when we lose somebody. You know, we're familiar with the archetype of the funeral, and even this seems to be kind of fading out of our modern life. You know, people die and then they just disappear, you know. But, you know, there are cultures in which funerals are a riotous good time. New Orleans, where we were last year, you know, you get marched into the cemetery by line bands. I want to go out like that. Or throw me an Irish wake, and you'll have Guinness and whiskey while you're talking stories about me, okay? But, man, let's come together. You know, I think we see this in our contemporary culture with this need for, this hunger for community when these spontaneous vigils appear, especially when a loss has been sudden. I think it amplifies that healing. You know, and a lot of times nowadays our grieving is done electronically. This is a friend of mine who tragically drowned trying to save a friend of his in Hawaii about 6 years ago. And his Facebook page, this is a much-loved Australian, you know, from tributes from all over the world were posted to his page. And now apparently Facebook will memorialize your page when you die, so you can be liking things from the great beyond. Now, many cultures have recognized this need for honoring loss. And where I live in San Francisco, you know, we have a lot of people from Latin America, particularly Mexico. And on the 2nd of November, which is Dia de los Muertos, we have this beautiful, lush celebration of death and loss. And it's really a celebration of life. And these altars, these family altars are made, and offerings of bread and tequila and beer and flowers. And people will paint their faces in what are called calacas. That's me at the bottom right. And finally, another way that we can collectively process grief is through building memorials. This is the National Memorial for Peace and Justice, which is also known as the National Memorial to Victims of Lynching, that just opened in the last couple of years in Montgomery, Alabama. As you travel through this memorial, I haven't seen it in person yet, but I understand your eyes travel skyward, your neck cranes up, and to see the names of people that were murdered by racist mobs. And in New York, at the site of the World Trade Center, this torrent of water falls into this seemingly bottomless hole at the base of the towers where they once stood. And in both cases, I have this experience of viscerally feeling the loss. Because I remember that feeling of just your gut falling out from under you on 9/11 as you watch those towers fall into the earth. But memorials don't need to be elaborate affairs. They can be made at home. They can be private. And this process can be deeply therapeutic. So I want to share with you, in closing, and I do realize I'm a little indulgent of your time, so I'll stick around afterwards if you want to come up and ask questions if we run out of Q&A time. But I want to talk to you about a contemporary ritual that I've been involved with for 20 years called Burning Man. And Burning Man is a temporary city now of 70,000 people that emerges on a dry lake bed in the Nevada desert. And in that city, we create imagine a do-it-yourself Disney World, right? So kind of the weirdest do-it-yourself Disney World you can imagine. So that's me with a unicorn on my head. And at the, so what this event centers around is this giant wooden man, which is then burned at the end of the week in this big kind of Bacchanalian celebratory event. But there's been, in more recent years, this phenomenon known as the temple. And the temple is this gorgeous, elegant building that is different every year. It's really what it is a secular repository for the grief of a community. And what people do there is they leave tributes. They're gorgeous buildings. They're absolutely gorgeous buildings. So they leave tributes, shrines. You're encouraged to write on the wood of the walls. So there's the interior one. So you see these sort of shrines that get built. And then at the end of the week, on Sunday, it's burned in a very kind of solemn, gentle event. It's not Bacchanalian in the least. And with that, the event comes to a close, and we clean up and we go home. And in 2014, so I camp with a group of about 50 people, and these are, you know, we come from all over the world. I've got friends from Argentina and from New York and Kentucky and Australia, and we come together once a year, and a lot of times this is the only place they get to see these folks. It's kind of like here. And you know, we joke, we call this the chosen family reunion, because these are really just wonderful people that I love. And in 2014, we lost my friend Rob Moon, who was a, as you can see from that smile, that is how he looked most of the time you saw him. He was just the sweetest, happiest guy you could ever meet. And sadly, before Christmas in 2014, he fell down a flight of stairs in New York City and broke his neck and died that night. And so I knew that we had to do something to honor Rob, and because when we gathered about 8 months later, so I built a shrine for him out of wood, painted it, and I made it so it could be carried, kind of like you might carry a coffin, almost. It's heavy, and we built, and so we came together as a community one night, and we told stories about Rob. And I have a bunch of friends in this camp that sing in a men's choir in San Francisco that only does the songs of Leonard Cohen. They're called the Conspiracy of Beards. If you get a chance to see them, they're wonderful. And they sang Hallelujah, which. Let's see if I can get through this. So we came together, and then at the end of the week, we carried it out the mile and a half out to the temple. And as I said, it was meant to be heavy, because grief is heavy. And sometimes you need to feel it in your body, and we left it for it to be burned. And this is a really deeply healing ritual for all of us. So I want to leave with a few closing words, and then I'll be happy to stick around for questions. You know, so it's been my hope that this presentation has been to acknowledge the burdens of grief, but also to note how grief makes us more alive. And I'm reminded of the words of Nietzsche. He said, "I want to learn more and more to see as beautiful what is necessary in things. Then I shall be one of those who makes things beautiful. Amor fati, let that be my love henceforth. I do not want to wage war against that which is ugly. I do not want to accuse. I do not even want to accuse those who accuse. Looking away shall be my only negation. All in all, and on the whole, I want to be. Someday, I wish to be only a yes-sayer." Or as even more succinctly, Dag Hammarskjöld, who was the second Secretary General of the UN, said, "For all that has been, thanks. And for all that shall be, yes." And this call to pay attention to grief is really a clarion call to pay attention to our lives. The mythologist Michael Mead said, there's an African proverb, "When death finds you, may it find you alive." And alive means living your own damn life, not the life that your parents wanted or the life that some cultural group or political party wanted, but the life that your own soul wants to live. So my hope is that you don't leave this talk feeling worse than you came in. What I hope for is that you to feel more deeply alive and more connected to the world around you and the people in it. So I want to close with one last poem from David Whyte. It's called "Everything is Waiting for You." And your great mistake is to act the drama as if you are alone, as if life were a progressive and cunning crime with no witness to the tiny hidden transgressions. To feel abandoned is to deny the intimacy of your surroundings. I love that line. To feel abandoned is to deny the intimacy of your surroundings. Surely, even you at times have felt the grand array, the swelling presence, and the chorus crowding out your solo voice. You must note the way the soap dish enables you, or the window latch grants you freedom. Alertness is the hidden discipline of familiarity. Alertness is the hidden discipline of familiarity. The stairs are your mentor of things to come. The doors have always been there to frighten you and invite you. And the tiny speaker in the phone is your dream ladder to divinity. Put down the weight of your aloneness and ease into the conversation. The kettle is singing, even as it pours you a drink. The cooking pots have left their arrogant aloofness and seen the good in you at last. All the birds and the creatures of the world are unutterably themselves. Everything, everything, everything is waiting for you. Thank you. So I think we're out of time for proper questions, but I'm happy to stick around and talk with people if you'd like. There is, I think 15 minutes, the bipolar antidepressant debate that will be happening down the road.